WHO is going to establish a classical totalitarian structure and wants to make sure that the value of the national constitutions become zero. And if you analyze well these international health regulations, you will find five elements that show that very clear. Number one, there's a mechanism of self-empowerment that already exists today, but which will be enlarged to a horrible extent. It will be even more simple than until today for one person, the general director, to declare a public health emergency of international concern. I spare you with the details, but he can simply just say the word into the microphone. Second element, all what WHO will publish under the title of recommendations will become mandatory. I gladly stay at disposal to any media to prove that. There are still today many officials who say the opposite, who say, no, this will just be recommendations, not mandatory. That's not true. They will become mandatory. Number three, fundamental rights. With such a regime where you have one person declaring emergency law, having all the power to make recommendations that are legally binding, you don't have to even discuss about human fundamental rights and whether they are now still crossed out in Article 3 or whether they might put it back into, it will not change the result. There will be no effective protection on the country level for fundamental human rights. Number four is specifically frightening because as human beings and trying to pursue the ideals of the Enlightenment, as very well explained by Matthias Desmet, we depend on the right information. Now, in both of these instruments, in the new pandemic treaty and in the amended health regulations, we have both provisions that clearly say WHO shall be the only sole institution on the planet that will be allowed to define what is the truth in health matters, including censorship. And the fifth point is that there's no mechanism of correction. There's no mechanism of control vis-a-vis WHO that could correct any wrong recommendation or a wrongly declared public health emergency of international concern. No, they can just go on forever and forever. And all of this, of course, we know it is done in the interest not of our health, but in the interest of those sponsors who define the true strategy behind it. Now, it doesn't take a study of law to come to the conclusion that this will heavily affect and reduce the ordinary structure of our constitutions actually to a minimum. There will be no separations of powers. There will be no checks and balances. This principle of the rule of law will be as abolished and replaced by the rule of emergencies. And most notably, there will be no human rights. Now, this is something, this is so powerful, and we have seen that this message has not come across to the public. And there has literally non-debate taking place in any parliament with very few exceptions. And I shall mention one exception is Andrew Bridgen, member of British Parliament, who rightfully persisted and insisted in bringing this topic to the floor of the House in the British Parliament. And he succeeded. And I'm honored that he is here with us today, Andrew Bridgen. And so does also Gerald Hauser. He did the same. He made the case in the Austrian Parliament that WHO's power structure should be made a topic of discussion. Now, I come to the point, it is all about how can we engage the parliaments? How can we engage the public? And this initiative of today is a very, very valid tool of starting public awareness and starting public debate in an international level on an international stage and then continue with informing people. Because I am sure about one thing. Many people slept in the past. But if the same people would understand what is coming to them in the future, they would have an informed dissent. They would be horrified and would certainly not agree into this permanent power structure of WHO, Gavi, and of course also the European Commission is the little junior partner of WHO, is doing the same. So let's continue by informing our fellow citizens. And here I wanted to thank you again to the 7 European citizens that initiated this European Citizens Initiative, because I think it is a very powerful tool to initiate a public debate and to bring this where it has to be discussed to our parliaments. Thank you very much.